right, good morning. So congratulations on being selected to be UE 100 instructors next fall. That is a huge, huge compliment to how successful you've been in college already. And today we're going to talk about professionalism and building positive student relationships. So a little bit about me, and I was listening to when you all introduced yourselves earlier, and it's great to have so many different majors represented. Go Teacher Ed, somebody over here. Teacher Ed, were you the, and yeah, okay, here's the girl. So anyway, so my name is Dr. Suzanne Hall, and this is my first year back at Southern. Missouri Southern is where I got my undergrad from. And from here, my husband and I went to the University of Missouri Columbia for our graduate degrees. And from there, we landed in Fulton, Missouri, where Cameron's from. And I went up and I introduced myself to him and I said, you know, you don't really know me because you never landed in my office, which is a great thing. So I'm a retired assistant superintendent. I taught in elementary. I did most of my time in middle school. Teaching 7th and 8th grade social studies at Fulton Middle School. Before that, and then after that, I was a building level administrator and then an assistant superintendent for my last 13 years in Fulton, Missouri, before coming back home. This is home. So I'm excited to be here. Let's talk about professionalism. Who can tell me, or actually, just think about it for a second. I'm in this room once a month presenting, so there we go. So, think about what professionalism means to you. And I want you to think about it for about 30 seconds, and then I want you to turn to your shoulder partner, and I want you to share what you believe that means. Okay, think about it. Okay, turn and talk. Sam, why don't you share what you think professionalism is?
I think professionalism is, if for an example, when you're like the leader of an organization or a manager, you are making unbiased and non-personal choices to better the group as a whole, rather than letting your emotions come into play and affect any decisions or how you react to the situation.
Perfect. Jordan.
I said presenting yourself in an appropriate and respectful manner.
Okay, presenting yourself in an appropriate and respectful manner. Maya.
Being mature and handling things from an unbiased perspective, just with understanding.
Okay, being mature, handling issues in an unbiased perspective. Brian.
I think it's like the way you build your interpersonal skills with people, like at the workplace, and like how you communicate effectively.
Okay, so communicating effectively, building those skills. You know, professionalism actually, when you ask our corporate friends, you know, they sometimes have a hard time nailing down a definition. You guys did a beautiful job, which I truly appreciate because you're on the right track, and it's probably one of the reasons why you're sitting around these tables right now. Is because you exuded a level of professionalism and they identified that within you as a good dispositional trait and decided you would be great to teach UE 100. So Bill Winsmer, he wrote a book called The Power of Professionalism, and he said that professionalism is the grease that lubricates an organization's functional gear. Raise your hand if you've ever witnessed somebody, maybe it was you, being unprofessional. Who would like to share? No names. No names, no names. Or organizations. You can't name names or organizations. Okay, yeah.
I have a producer at a temper tantrum in my office. And he was a respected member of the Halloween community. He just had a little 2-year-old tantrum.
Tantrums happen, sadly.
It's not professional.
It's not professional, exactly. Who else? Who else would like to share? Nick?
I worked in a job once where there was someone who asked me out and I didn't want to, but my boss told me that I had to be socially, like go out and do things with them.
Really? That's against the law.
Yeah.
I was a Title IX coordinator for a long time and it's like, that is not acceptable. Chris, you had your hand up.
I did. Day after the Super Bowl, I got back to my job.
I'm sorry, you're a 49ers fan.
I get back to my job, and the assistant store manager of the place I work at just gave me a bunch of crap.
Really? Yeah, that's not very professional.
Like, there's like friendly banter. Like,
right.
Yeah, y'all lost. Right?
Yeah. I always just tell people, I'm just so sorry. You know, I'm sorry you're a 49ers fan. I love San Francisco, don't get me wrong, but. Most of us are like, if you're from Missouri, it's really hard not to be a Chiefs fan. So, anyway, within that right, Cameron. You don't like the Chiefs? Oh my gosh. I have an advisee who doesn't like the Chiefs. And I'm like, are you kidding me? He's from Arkansas, though. But you, I'd expect you to like the Chiefs. Who do you like?
The Steelers.
They're okay.
Yeah.
Okay, who else would like to share before we get off topic? And I'm real easy to get off topic, so my apologies. Chelsea. Did you have your hand up earlier? Oh, you did not.
Well, you know, I witnessed it, but I don't, it was weird because she was a manager out of my old job, and it was a fast food restaurant, or a fast food place, and so sometimes when we would mess up the customer's order, we would give them, like, photo cards, is what we call them, and she would actually fill them out and give them to her lady. And she worked at another location than I did, that I wanted to work with her for the company. And I knew her boyfriend was because I was in school with him. And he would come through a couple different times and use them. The first time, and then I ended up reporting it to my manager and just eating hostage.
Yeah, so that's not only unprofessional, but it's unethical. And so we're going to talk about being ethical as well. So being professional means you are on time. You cannot walk in late. If you're the instructor for UE100, you should never walk in late. You need to dress appropriately. Let's talk about appropriate dress for a second. So once a month, I have the honor of working with all of the student teachers we have placed each semester. And this semester we have about 70 student teachers out there, Lauren being one of them. And so, anyway, we always, you know, one of the things I told them, I said, every single one of you will have a job by this time next year, actually, probably by the end of the semester, as long as you don't show up in pajamas for your interview. And they probably think that's a silly statement. I interviewed people for 15 years and hired them. And I can tell you, the outfits they would walk in, and I know men don't wear outfits, my son tells me that all the time. Anyway, but whatever they walk in, it's like, are you kidding me? So, appropriate dress. So, appropriate dress for UE100. What would that be? Let me ask you this. What shouldn't it be? What should you not wear? What?
No leggings.
No leggings? I want leggings.
That's different.
Okay.
Not the yoga pants.
Okay. No yoga pants. Okay. What else? Somebody else.
Like no gym clothes and whatnot.
Maybe no gym clothes. What about advertisements?
State of Missouri employee, you're not allowed to wear only jeans, any kind of shirt with advertisements or any kind of wording on it at all. You know, sports teams, unless we've been pre-approved by the Myers department head, you can wear that. Like, the Chiefs want to see the logo. Chiefs, I wanted to work 49ers and not a Chiefs fan.
not a 49ers fan either. Go Bears.
No yoga pants, leggings, only with a shirt or a dress that is long enough to cover.
Yep, cover the backside. Yep.
Right. And when you reach your hands above your head, it'll bend over and you have to still remain
check. Exactly. Yep. Yeah, you just need to make sure that you appear to be the one in charge, okay? So, this is not how I typically dress when this is Friday over in the education department. This is pretty casual for me. So, it's just really important to exude that professionalism. And so appropriate dress is one of them. If you have a favorite, Stella Beer shirt that you love or whatever, don't wear it to class when you're teaching, okay? Also know your audience. So I learned a lot about you all whenever you guys were introducing yourself earlier. And so it's really important to know who you're addressing. So I'm sure you're gonna learn a lot of icebreakers, you're gonna get to know your students, but some of you may have classes of 40. And don't feel awful if you don't know everybody's name by the end of the first 2 weeks. It happens. But you will learn them over the time that you have them. Make sure you are knowledgeable. It's okay to say that you don't understand or you don't know something if asked. I'm asked, not every day, but sometimes, I'm asked a question and I'm like, I don't know the answer, but I know how to find it and I will get back to you. Or provide them the resources. It's okay not to know everything, but you really need to know what you're talking about. Because if you get up and you start talking about something, and they're going to see right through you if you're a fake. So just remember that. And I'm sure you all have been in those situations where somebody's standing in front of you and you're like, what are they talking about? It happens. I had somebody tell me just this week that same-sex marriage was unconstitutional. And I'm like, no, you're wrong. So, and it's okay also just to call people out. So, politely, on the side, not in front of the class. If somebody says something to you or to the class, just visit with them afterwards. Remain that you keep that high level of professionalism. Make sure you're a good role model. Don't come in with your hair all messed up. If you stayed up until 2 a.m. studying for a final, and you have an 8 a.m. class. Does any of them have an 8 a.m. class?
Probably.
I love 8 a.m. classes. They're my favorites. And I always tell my students, I'm like, I'm so glad you're here. Because if you're an education major and you have me at 8 a.m., if you can't survive being in my class at 8 a.m., you are going to fail as a teacher because they will eat you alive that first hour of the day. So you need to make sure that you're awake and that you are ready to go. You're going to put on your best face, okay? And then, and we've talked about this a little bit, knowing your boundaries, you have to make sure that you remain ethical in every decision that you make, and you also should not ask out your students. You can't do that. It's against the law, and it's amazing. I still can't believe they told you that.
Unprofessional environment.
Yeah. Oh my gosh. Yeah. That you had to.
Had to end it. There was more, not just with him, but like, we had to have a friendship outside of work is how she worked it. I said, no, we don't.
No, you don't.
You don't want me here.
No. Nobody can tell you who you have to be friends with, okay? You all should get along as colleagues, but you don't have to be best buds. So, yeah. Crazy, crazy world. So in 2012, this study revealed that, and you guys, some of you may be Generation Y, but there's a conflict actually with Gen Y and Gen Xers that we're starting to see evolve in the workplace. And this was from 2012. It's even a little bit more challenging today. So, how many of you have your cell phone on the table right now? How many of you have, it's okay, raise your hand. You're not gonna be in trouble. Okay, so in 2012, it was somewhat of an issue. If you look at says, you know, the obsession with technology is hindering recent hires and their ability to maintain a strong, qualified presence on the job. The study reported 83% of new hires excessively using social media at work. 82% text at inappropriate times during the day. And the most common interview mistake of recent graduates is inappropriate attire at 40%. So it's so important that you are a good role model and you have that professional presence with your students. But something that I see over and over and over with our student teachers who are out there in the field right now, they have to submit lesson plans four times during the semester, and I read through them all. And so many of them say, especially at the secondary level, say, cell phones. That's the issue. It is such an issue. And when they, and because all these kids, and my apologies, young people and young professionals, they are so used to having that. I mean, it's a part of our lives. Mine's in my purse, but it's on silent. Because I was in a text group this morning and it was blowing up. So it was just like, I don't have time for this right now. You know, put it on silent, put it away. But you are gonna run into that. And you're gonna have to figure out how to approach that if it becomes a distractor in your UE 100 class. So just briefly, I want you to turn to your shoulder partner and I want you to discuss how you would address that. If it becomes an issue, how are you going to address that? Because remember, you've got to remain professional. What are you going to do? What rule could you establish early on with these your students? Go ahead, turn and talk. Share out. Cameron, we're going to start with you.
Setting guidelines early.
Okay, setting guidelines early, and what guideline would you set?
If I don't have your phones out when you're discussing things.
Okay, don't have your phones out when you're discussing things. Okay, who else? Okay, great.
So, comm professors establish this, which I think is nice. They don't want your phones out, but they understand you have a life, so keep it on silent. And if you have an emergency, just let them know beforehand if you can, but if something comes up, just take your phone and go out of class, and then if something happens, you have to leave, just let them know.
Yeah, so keeping it on silent, and then if an emergency comes up, just step out. Okay, who else? Chloe.
So we kind of talked about how, like, you know, keeping like phones either face on their desk or like in their bag, but at the same time, like, technology isn't a bad thing. So if we have to use it for something like in class, like a Kahoot or like some sort of game like that, just say like, hey, like this is the time you can have it out, just to show that like technology like isn't bad. It's just that there are times when it's appropriate not to use it.
Ella.
Yeah, we basically talked about the same stuff. So
I read
that
it's
kind of just like establishing that control
and
trust and stuff.
Yeah, and that's one thing. Establishing trust, and we're going to talk about building positive student relationships here in a second, but establishing trust early on. And so what I always tell my students in my class is that I don't care if you have your cell phone out. I don't care if it's on, it needs to be turned down low, if you put it on silent, just make sure it's not distracting from what we're trying to accomplish during class today. And honor them, respect them, because I mean, just like you, if somebody's phone went off, it would not even bother me. And it's just because that's just who I am. But some people, it would like be on their every last nerve. So yeah, so establish, like Cameron said, establish, you know, the guidelines and rules early, and just let them know what your expectations are. And then you can also see the essential qualities of professionalism, which we've covered. We haven't really talked about confidence, but if you know, if you're knowledgeable, you're going to be confident. And we talked about this. Nothing really shocks me anymore. So I've been at this game for a long, long time. And you may be shocked this coming semester in the fall. Somebody may do something or say something, and you just have that, you have to have your game face on, okay? They may say something that you find completely inappropriate, and you have to figure out how you're going to move on. You can't let it disrupt or change the culture of your class. You just have to suck it up. And it's hard, it's so, so hard. I've had to counsel a lot of teachers out of jobs before, meaning they were no longer in the district because they did some really dumb things. You can't necessarily kick somebody out of your class, but you can have hard conversations with them, okay? So what, maybe not frightens, but what causes you concern about having a class of your own students? Anybody have any concerns? My biggest concern was just working through Blackboard because it was new to me when I came on campus. No concerns? You probably won't know what kind of concerns to have until you've gotten through your first week. And at the end of your first week, you're going to be like, oh my gosh, what am I doing? But you guys will be rock stars, I promise. If you think of something, let me know. So Mindy Cowling, sometimes you just have to put on the lip gloss and pretend to be psyched. There are going to be some days that you walk in and you are going to be tired. Maybe you just finished a test and you didn't do as great as you thought you would. But you have to have that positive attitude when you walk into class, because they need you. You know, it's UE100. Who can tell me something they remember from their UE100 instructor that made you want to be here today?
The actual instructor, of course.
The actual instructor. Okay.
You could really tell, he's not a teacher anymore. You could tell that he was really wanting to inform all of us, like, about campus and everything. And so if he seems involved, then, I want to be involved.
Okay. All right. Anybody else? What about the course itself? Chris? Was it the course that you were thinking about, or?
Well, I wanted to take this because I wanted the opportunity to help the freshmen know what's up with campus, how to navigate where everything is. So it was kind of daunting for me in the first couple of weeks, kind of knowing where everything is, where to go.
Right. Yeah, if you are coming from, and so some of you, heard that you're from Pierce City. So, you know, some of you, if you're from a smaller campus that you graduated from, and then you come to Missouri Southern, you know, it's a big campus. Missouri State in Springfield is a big campus, and they have far more students than we do, but they're landlocked. And so you can only go so far before you have to cross a major road and get ran over. So here, you know, walking from here all the way to business building, you need to, and that's probably the hardest thing for freshmen to figure out, is how to plan your time so you can make it to class on time if you have to hike across campus to get to your next class. I had an advisee come in a few weeks ago, and he wanted to drop class because he couldn't figure that part out. And he's a freshman. And I said, oh no. I said, we can do this. I said, I'm not signing off on your paper, because he's passing the class. He just couldn't get there on time. And so he's like, oh, but my grade's gonna drop. And I said, figure it out. I said, come back and see me in another week or so if you can't. So, yeah, but it's a challenge. But sometimes So building positive relationships with your students are going to be the foundation for everything you do. If you can't earn their trust within the first few days, or weeks, maybe weeks, if you're going to have a challenge with some of your students. So I want you to reflect and be prepared to share out your why on your favorite and least favorite classroom experience. It can be from your K-12 experiences, maybe it was your kindergarten teacher, or your college. You cannot share names, okay? So I want you to think about it. Your best and worst class experience. I'll start. My favorite teacher ever was my high school biology teacher. I'm a Webb City High School graduate. Like I said, I was born and raised here, but she was amazing. She was engaging. We had a great time. Even in, back then, we had to skin the cat and we had to learn all the muscles and all the arteries and veins and nerves, et cetera, et cetera. So anyway, we had a great, great time in that class. And that was advanced biology. I also had her for regular biology. She was my favorite teacher ever. My worst teacher ever was my high school algebra teacher. I've never felt so stupid in my entire life. And so it's just like, are you kidding me? I mean, he almost made it seem like girls could not learn math. And it was, drove me crazy. And so back then, I'm really old, but back then, you only had to have one math credit, or one 3-hour math credit, in the state of Missouri to graduate with honors. And so I graduated with honors with one high school math class. And you can only imagine what that did to my ACT score. It was not pretty. And so I had to retake the ACT like 2 or 3 times. But my worst and my favorite. Who else would like to share? Worst and favorite. Carrie.
My worst experience was probably
third grade. Okay.
And one main thing I remember about this year, of course, we had a teacher who had such a good entire day. And I chose the class at Oklahoma. And we had a spelling here in class. And I spelled my work correctly. She said it was wrong. And everybody was like, right, what's going on? And it was just like the worst experience ever. And then my best was probably, I had the same, I went to school mostly in Tennessee, and I had the same teacher for algebra 1, algebra 2, and geometry. And by the time we got to geometry, I was in the A's of math, it just always was. And she was just, as long as I didn't disrupt the class, I could sleep, I could do my homework, I could, you know, do whatever I wanted, as long as I didn't disrupt her class. Because she's like, if she's asking questions and nobody else is answering, like, okay, Carrie, what's the answer?
There you go.
Because I was just a wizard.
And that's fantastic. I can balance a $21 million budget, which I did for 13 years in Fulton, Missouri, but Algebra 1, that teacher, I still, oh my gosh, I don't know what I would say to him today if I saw him face to face.
My daughter had similar experience. She just had a horrible teacher.
Yeah. Don't be the horrible teacher. Somebody had their hand raised. Sam.
My weightlifting coach, volleyball coach, told all the parents that my parents were doing divorce. Cool. But they've been married for 4 years this year, so they weren't. So that was weird and like not a good memory from high school. But my best was also high school, my drafting teacher. I wasn't very good at math, but I was good at the designing portion. So he would always work extra with me and really encourage the skills that I did have and, you know, always talked about how good of a job I did, even though I didn't necessarily
I still get to learn and I'm able to try to get to my family and do this. But I guess the best is also just to pass all those semesters without some of the teaching.
Yeah, getting to know people, getting to know your students, and then not caring, basically, the other one. So.
My best teacher was my high school history teacher. He was just so engaging, and I love the fact that you have like a math with that group in there. Like, you, in the beginning of every class, like, go on, like, it'd be in the middle of the semester, and he would, like, have us tell the story, like, all the day of what we learned in the class, and so we would remember it every time, and he just, like, pulled on it, and people would remember the story. My worst was just a horrible experience. This teacher just did not like anyone who is a special ed student and has autistic. And so, like, she just sought me out and a couple other kids in the class. Well, there's one time we were, like, making applesauce or something since we were, like, first grade. And she comes up to me and it's like, let me help you cut that for you. I'm thinking, because we have plastic knives and apple, like, okay, whatever, just taking a few, what's she gonna do to me out? And she got me a son of a little stuff from it. And she blended on me. She was like, you need to go to the nurse and get the other work. But she was like, cutting with it pretty deep. And I went to the nurse and I told her, and she's like, no, there's no way. And I'm like, yes. And my older brother, he was the teacher's pet in his class. Like, he would come to my class, like, give the teacher notes and stuff. And he would see how awful the teacher treated me. And, like, I would tell my dad, like, no, like, she's really, really evil. She got fired 2 years later for teaching students. But, so I guess that's good. But she was just an awful, mean teacher.
And I'm sorry you had to experience that.
Yeah, no, okay.
Nobody should have to experience
that.
She is done. So, who else? Somebody else had their hand over here.
My best experience is probably my freshman year geometry teacher. I wasn't very good at math, but she worked with me and pushed me. She wasn't easy, but she pushed me and got me working to it, and I finally started to get it. My worst experience was probably my kindergarten year in my music class. And my teacher went, like, called me out from the whole class and ridiculed me, and I went home crying to my mom that day. So I was kindergarten year. But that was probably the worst experience.
Isn't it amazing that you can remember, that you can remember your best and worst experiences, and no matter how old you are, you're always gonna remember your best and your worst. And if somebody says, well, I never had a bad experience, baloney, I guarantee you at some point you probably did. Maybe you didn't recognize it, but sometimes people just aren't kind either, or engaging, or caring, and you have to be. One thing, I think one of the challenges you're gonna have is, you know, how are you going to approach when your students, not all of them are showing up? I have an advisee, and I make him check in with me once or twice a week. And he was going to drop out at the end of last semester, and we had a long discussion. And I said, buddy, I said, this is your chance to make a difference. And he's still in, and so just yesterday, he popped in my office, you know, and so, yeah. So he, I mean, it's just so important to establish those relationships early. So strategies for building positive student relationships, and the slides that I printed off for you, the note pages, they're tiny, and my apologies. Be intentional. As I've already said, positive relationships are the foundation for learning success. Your students are going to be engaged if they know you are there and you have a purpose. Students are people too. Learn their names quickly and correctly. Sometimes, like the very first day, I don't know if you, I had to deal with like every year, every teacher I ever had, I had to work through my name. And so, because my first name is Lisa, but my mother, why I have no idea, never chose to call me Lisa. She called me Suzanne. And she went, and that's my middle name. And so, but what shows up on the roster every year of, you know, is Lisa. And so then I have to go through the whole, well, I go by Suzanne. Well, Suzanne's not on here. Well, that's what I, you know, so anyway. But anyway, so here's my recommendation to you. If you are uncomfortable trying to figure out somebody's name, when you look at your roster, you know, one of the things you can do is you can go through and you can actually just call their last name and ask them what they would prefer to be called. You know, what you know, so they're going to say, I'm going to call your last name. You introduce yourself to the class using your first name or what your name that you would prefer to be called by. I mean, there's just so many different ways you can approach this. I'm sure you'll get lots of training on that as well. But sometimes that's what I'll do, is I'll just call the last name and just say, I want you to introduce yourself as to how we should, you know, call on you the rest of this semester. Value the student's voice and time. You will be surprised at the outcome. I always tell my students that I start and end on time. And that's one thing I meant to do was set my alarm on my phone, because I do that in every class that I teach, because I value your time. You know, people have places to go and they have things to do. And so don't keep them too long. And also make sure that you value their voice. If they have something to say, let them say it. If it's completely inappropriate, you can visit and have that conversation with them afterwards. If they offend the whole class, you will also need to have that conversation afterwards and ask, and then you're gonna have to approach it the next class period. Sometimes those things happen. You need to provide structure. It's going to increase learning. If you go in and it's just a free-for-all, you will be eaten alive. I've seen it way too many times. You need to teach with enthusiasm. If you're not enthusiastic, if you're not willing to put on the lip gloss and be psyched that day, you know, they're gonna feel it. So be enthusiastic. Also incorporate humor in your lessons. Students love to laugh as they learn. I always tell crazy stories. You know, make them realize that you're human and you were in their shoes once too. If you have a funny story about something that happened in UE100 when you were in that class, share it. You know, if you got lost on campus, or you walked into the wrong classroom, oh my gosh. So the mansion, raise your hand if you know what the mansion is. Hallelujah. Okay, so the mansion, that's where our history classes were when I was on this campus. And Webster wasn't built, okay? It was a grassy lawn. And so, but I can remember more than once, and I don't know why I did this, my first master's degree is in geography. I mean, I'm really good geographically, but I kept walking in the wrong classroom. And it almost got to be like, I would walk in and the professor, Dr. Smith, he would say, who taught geography? He would say, would you like to sit down and have class with us today? I'm like, nope, I am trying to get to government. So anyway, but you know, just share with them. Let them know everybody's human and we all make mistakes. And then apologize when you mess up. Boy, if you can own up to something that you said wrong, they are going to respect you so much more. Nobody's perfect. And if you think you are, fantastic. Communicating positive expectations, you need to make sure that you have the same expectations for all your students. If you allow somebody to start missing class and you don't address it, you know, others are gonna say, well, you know, my aide is in this class, why can't I? It's obvious that she, you know, nothing's being done to her. So make sure that you have high behavioral and academic expectations for everyone. Give everybody a chance to participate in class. This is really more challenging than what you realize. I know I haven't called on every single one of you, which is driving me crazy right now, but I promise I will by the time we're finished. Abigail, you're probably next. Monitor equitability. So you need to make sure that it's equitable, everything that you do. You know, I said know your audience. You need to make sure that you don't cross any boundaries. You need to make sure that you address everybody. And we're gonna talk about being culturally sensitive here in just a second. But last year, I presented at a national conference on being equitable. And so this is something that's going to be a challenge for you, because I've been doing this for 30 years and I still haven't mastered it. There's always room for growth. So make sure that you are equitable in all things that you do with your students. Let students know that you believe in them and they have the ability to do well. I mean, if my Algebra 1 teacher in high school had just believed that I could, I probably would have done better. I mean, I was thankful to get a B in the class. Not that B is bad, but I had to work really, really hard because he wasn't any help. And I would really love to share his name with you because his name is sort of funny, but I'm not going to. Because if you don't believe in them, they're going to tune you out. And they're going to be off task. And so off task behaviors, you know, you are going to have to figure out how to get everybody back together. In education world, we have something called callbacks. And so, and my education friends are not going to head over here. So, but callbacks, they're silly, but sometimes it works. So whether you're an accounting major or a pre-med major, and you're leading that UE100 class, and if they are completely off base and you can't get them back because you don't have a great teacher voice, some of you have a very soft voice, and it's just like, okay, you're going to figure this out. But so one callback, and you probably had this when you were in school too. You know, the teacher would say, class, class, and they would say what?
Yes, yes.
Yes, yes. Or somebody would say, flat tire, and they would say what? Did I hear it? Yes, that was you. I was like, yeah, it's just like, you know, flat tire, you say flat tire, and they went, shh, because it's all the air going out of the tire. I mean, you can figure out funny ones and make them even, like, you could say lions, and they could say what? What do lions do? Roar, okay? If you want to connect it to Missouri Southern, you know, so there are things that you can do, but the first time that you can't get everybody back together, that's too late. So you need to establish that early on and say, okay, if we are having a fantastic discussion here and everybody's engaged and you've got 40 people in the room, you know, you're gonna have to be loud and proud and you're gonna have to let them know what your callback is or whatever. It's not elementary, folks. I mean, people at the high school level do it as well. Do you use a callback?
Yeah.
Every once in a while?
Yeah.
High school biology. Who's gonna have a job next year? So, she's so excited. So, anyway, so callbacks are important. And then redirect student behavior in a positive manner. Don't call somebody out in the middle of class, all right? You know, if Abigail was over here standing on her head, I would not say, Abigail, you need to be sitting in your seat. I might walk over to her and just say, you okay? You know, maybe she loves standing on her head. Maybe that's the best way that she learns. Who knows? Students are always going to remember how you make them feel. What time is it? 6 minutes. Okay. And some of you, when you're sharing your positives and negatives, I guarantee you those negatives, they didn't make you feel great. So you always need to make everybody feel they're important. And their presence matters. You also need to focus on soft skills, and I don't have really enough time to really get into the current research that's being done by this economist. But focus on the soft skills. Empathy, perseverance, being self-aware, being honest. If you can communicate those soft skills and teach your UE100 students those soft skills along the way, because you are modeling them, they are going to be very successful in their career here at Missouri Southern. Being culturally sensitive. Some of you may have heard the term being culturally responsive. But who can tell me, I don't even know that we have time for the YouTube video that I have. Who can tell me what culturally sensitive means? What do you think it means? There's no right or, oh, well, there's no wrong answers. I promise you. What does being culturally sensitive mean? Okay? Recognizing the individuality of people. But being culturally sensitive, don't ever tell somebody, and I couldn't tell any of you around the table, I know what your life is like. I understand. Because you have not lived in their shoes. You have to be culturally sensitive. Because it drives me crazy when I would have new faculty come into our district, and they would be like, oh yeah, I know what it's like to be, you know, 6 years old and just moved here from, you know, Mexico, and English is not my first language. And I have a clue. You have not walked in their shoes. And so you need to be culturally sensitive. we also have a lot of students on campus that are first-generation college students, you know? And so it's really important that you recognize that this is a huge step for them. That being culturally sensitive is really key. And so it's a newish term, which is sad. It shouldn't be a new term. You know, we should have all been culturally sensitive all these years. But it's really important to be culturally sensitive. And Google it, since we are running out of time. And I haven't called on Gail yet. I called on everybody else. Who haven't I called on? We've talked, right? We have not. Micah?
Yeah.
Okay. So, I'm going to have Micah and Abigail respond to this quote. Or that's not really a quote, but it's something else. I want you to think about what you're getting ready to do. And sadly, there's not going to be somebody in your class every day that you teach UE100. And I know you're going to be partnered up, which is going to be great. So it's probably going to be a good time to say this to each other. But a lot of times you don't get positive feedback on what a great job you're doing. You only hear the negative. And just like this watchmaker, you know, it's like nobody's ever told me that their watch was still working. You know, so thank you for letting me know your watch is still working. Typically people only tell me it's broken. It doesn't work. So Abigail, I want you to share what you will say, or how often you might say, to whoever your teaching partner is. How are you going to let them know that they're doing a great job?
I'm going, if they teach like a specific topic and they're the different students, I'm going to give them kind of like a chance report of, did a good job, the students really liked it, and see how that can add.
Okay, so giving that verbal positive feedback. Micah, what are you going to do? What are you going to do if your partner maybe messed up? What kind of feedback, Abigail, are you going to give them?
I'm not going to like freak out, maybe say that was awful. Maybe you should try something else. I'm going to say we can come up with different steps to more engage the students and maybe they just messed it up. And we'll talk about that later.
Okay, don't make me feel bad about it. Micah?
Just discuss it, go over where it went wrong, and then, you know, for the future, like, plan for the future, and all of it.
Yeah. So are you guys going to be, so will they have, are they doing fall and spring?
If they want to do it, yeah, they can do it if you were to do it.
Okay, all right, yeah. So, yeah, especially, I mean, in the future, maybe we need to talk about this, or maybe we can change this up, or whatever. It's really hard when something has gone awry, but always focus on the positive. You make that Oreo cookie positive, what we can improve on, and then end with a positive. So, and do that with your students as well. So anyway, questions? I'm sorry you haven't been out of your seats in an hour. It's not like me. So we do all kinds of exercise in seminar class in the morning. So anyway, okay. Thank you for what you're getting ready to do. If you're ever in Taylor Hall, please pop in and see me. I would love to see you. You guys are gonna be awesome. I appreciate you being leaders at Missouri Southern. I love the school, and hopefully, apparently you do too. Otherwise you wouldn't be going on this journey. So thank you very much.